the close of probation and removal of sin. Otherwise, it says the Lord has clearly shown me that the image of the beast will be formed before something happens. What is it that we're going to learn? But we want to talk about the close of probation and the removal of sin. But I want to just notice a few texts, first of all, because when we think about the removal of sin, and we think about the cleansing of the sanctuary, we may at times be tempted to put all of our emphasis on this magnificent, grandiose structure that is in heaven for God in Christ. And we fail to realize that ultimately cleansing is us. We are the thing that ultimately needs cleansed. The sanctuary can't be cleansed until we are cleansed. But I'd like for us to look at just some texts about the cleansing of the soul temple. And I put these texts here in references on the slides for us. And the first text we're going to look at is in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 16. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16. There the Apostle Paul says, "Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you?" And then he tells us the seriousness of this in verse 17. "And if any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy, for the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are." Now, that in no way says that there's not also a temple in heaven. We're not trying to imply that by any way. But ultimately, God wants to dwell within and in His people. And for that to happen, we must become a clean people. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 19, another text you should be familiar with, he says, "What, know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? For ye are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body, your spirit, which are God's." Boy, there's a good text, you know, for health reform right there. Did you realize that? Because we all think about glorifying God in our spirit, you know, doing the things that are right in spirit. But what about our bodies too, friends? We have to take care of our bodies and be very particular about what goes in them and how we work them and take care of them. But it says that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 16, he says, "In what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people." He says, ye are the temple of the living God. So if that's true, then I'll ask a question then. The question we have here on our screen. What was the attitude of the serious, devout worshiper on the day? Do you think that when the Day of Atonement came, that those people came with a flippant, joyous, funny kind of attitude about everything? Friends, I want to tell you they were dead serious. In Leviticus chapter 16 and verse 29, please turn there and read this text with me. Referring to this service that has been clearly delineated and explained here in the first 28 verses, he says in verse 29, "And this shall be a statute forever unto you, that in the seventh month, on the tenth day of the month, ye shall afflict your souls and do no work at all, whether it be one of your own country or a stranger that sojourneth among you." He says that you are to afflict your souls. And he says it later again. It was to be a time of affliction of soul. You know what that means, don't you? We're searching our souls. We're serious about this. Mm-hmm. Are our sins forgiven? Are our lives brought into conformity with the holy standard of the divine law, which is a mirror of the character of God? In the book Great Controversy, on page 425, Great Controversy, page 425, we were told this: while the investigative judgment is going forward in heaven, while the sins of penitent believers are being removed from the sanctuary, there is to be a special work of purification, of putting away of sin among God's people upon the earth. And so, friends, this concept that the heavenly sanctuary must be cleansed and that it alone is cleansed is not complete. Because the only way it can truly be cleansed if we are completely cleansed, if we are purified. And she says that this is a special work of purification. Friends, this is a work that's never happened before in the history of this earth. It's never happened before like this for a corporate group of people. as Christians, as we look to Jesus ministering for us before the throne of God, what should that do to our lives, or what should be the result in our lives? And I want you to notice a couple texts here. First of all, in 1 John chapter 3, we'll read that one first. 1 John chapter 3, and we're going to begin reading in verse 1. John says, "Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is." Let me just stop there for a minute. Now, John's not trying to say that we're going to become divine. He's not saying we're going to become God. But what he says is that our characters, friends, are going to be like his. Now, did Jesus know sin? Did Jesus commit sin? Was he involved in sin? No. And the people of God at that time, friends, aren't going to be either. And so he goes on to tell the people in verse 3, "And every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he," as Christ, "is pure." As Christ is pure, we are to purify ourselves. And in Hebrews chapter 12, starting in verse 1, Paul writes, he says, "Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us. And let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus." Now, I want to stop here a minute. Paul says we're to look to Jesus. But if I don't know where Jesus is today, how can I look to Jesus? Does that make sense? Is that a fair question? And all through this epistle, the Apostle Paul has been presenting the priestly ministry of Christ in the heavenly sanctuary, presenting Christ as our advocate before the right hand of the Father. And in Daniel chapter 7, verses 9 and 10 there, and on into verse 13, you read there, and we read in our last presentation, about how one like the Son of Man comes before the Ancient of Days. And there's a movement. There's a movement from the time of Paul writing in Hebrews now, prophetically denoted in the book of Daniel, of movement from the holy place to the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary, where Christ now ministers what is called the final atonement for his people. But if we don't know where Jesus is, friends, it's hard to look to him there. It says, "Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that is set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God." Verse 3 now, Hebrews 12, 3. "For consider him that endured such contradiction or hostility of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. For ye have not resisted unto blood, striving against sin." As Christians, friends, are we to strive against sin? Strive sounds like something hard, doesn't it? It sounds like something that takes energy.
Proactive.
That's right, it's proactive. It's active. Striving against sin. And the Bible says that we must do this, lest we be wearied and faint in our minds. And the mind, friends, is where the battle is for. Now, it's true, Satan will try to battle against our body to get to our mind, to try to make us sick, to discourage us in our minds. But the Bible says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus," in Philippians chapter 2 and verse 5. The Bible says, "Let every thought be brought into obedience and captivity to the obedience of Christ," 2 Corinthians chapter 10. And so it's the mind that salvation comes through. In the Review and Herald of April 8, 1890, it says, "While Christ is cleansing the sanctuary, the worshipers on earth should carefully review their life and compare their character with the standard of righteousness." Remember in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul says, you know, "Let every man examine himself, whether he's of the faith or not." And so it says here that we should carefully review our lives and compare, it says, our character or their character with the standard of righteousness. Continuing, she says, "As they see their defects, they should seek the aid of the Spirit of God to enable them to have moral strength to resist the temptations of Satan and to reach the perfection of the standard." Let me just pause. What is that standard, friends? What is that standard? We're to reach the perfection of the standard.
That's right.
The Ten Commandments, which is the character of Christ. She goes on and says, they may be victors over some temptations, over every temptations, over the very temptations which seem too strong for humanity to bear, for the divine power will be combined with their human effort, and Satan cannot overcome them. 1 John chapter 4, verse 4 says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And so it doesn't matter to us how powerful Satan seems to be. Is Satan more powerful than me? Is he more powerful than you? Tons more. Tons more. But friends, Christ is infinitely greater than Satan. All I have to do is ally my weakness with the strength of Christ. And there is power to overcome. There is power to obey. Now let's talk about the close of probation. We hear this phrase in Adventism, the close of probation. First of all, what is probation? Have you thought about what probation even is? Well, the New Oxford American Dictionary defines probation this way. It is the release of an offender from detention subject to a period of good behavior under supervision. For instance, I went to court and was put on probation. Or the process or period of testing or observing the character or abilities of a person in a certain role. For example, a new employee, for an initial period of probation, your manager will closely monitor your progress. Now, that's a dictionary definition. But these two combined, these two portions together are pretty close to the theological concept of what we mean when we talk about probation. That we are already sitting under the sentence of death. And God has put us on a probation, as it were, to give us another chance. But in this chance, he is testing us. It is a process of testing or observing our character and our abilities to see if we can be faithful to walk the street of gold, to go through the pearly gates. Because, friends, God's got to know. And not only does he have to know, he has to know in a demonstrable way so others know. You think God knows everything about us already? Does God know if I'm going to be saved or not right now? Sure does. He knows everything. There's nothing hid from him. But what about all the intelligences of heaven? Do they understand that if God brings me into that, through one of those pearly gates onto that street of gold, that I'm going to be safe to keep there without marring everything? How do they know? This is all part of this process, friends, of this great controversy and the investigative judgment and the close of probation. Now, before that probation closes, God's going to give me the opportunity to prove that indeed I am worthy to walk on that street of gold and to not defile heaven up. Now, is there going to come a time when there will be an irrevocable divine decree that will fix the destiny of every human being? Yes, there is. We read about it in Revelation chapter 22. Let's turn there. Verse 11 and 12, Jesus says this, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still. Now, Jesus hasn't said this yet, but there's coming a time when Jesus will say this. He that is unjust, let him be unjust still. And he which is filthy, let him be filthy still. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be. And so before Jesus comes and he brings his reward with him, there is this irrevocable divine decree given. And Ellen White comments on this in Spiritual Gifts, Volume 1, page 197. She says this, I saw angels hurrying to and fro in heaven. An angel returned from the earth with a writer's inkhorn by his side and reported to Jesus that his work was done, that the saints were numbered and sealed. Let me just pause here for a minute. Where in the Bible do you read about an angel or one with a writer's inkhorn?
Ezekiel.
Ezekiel. That's right. And you had those abominations in Ezekiel 8 and 9, and God's response to that. And that angel is going to go out and seal God's people. It says, continuing, then I saw, notice again, I saw Jesus who had been ministering before the ark containing the Ten Commandments, throw down the censer. He raised his hands upward and with a loud voice said, "It is done," and all the angelic hosts laid off their crowns as Jesus made the solemn declaration, "He that is unjust, let him be unjust still, and he which is filthy, let him be filthy still, and he that is righteous, let him be righteous still, and he that is holy, let him be holy still." So notice the sequence. The saints are sealed. Jesus stands up. He throws the censer down. And he makes this irrevocable divine pronouncement. Now you can read this same statement in early writings. But I want to continue this statement in spiritual gifts, because in spiritual gifts, it's just a little different here. In early writings, it says, every case was then decided. In early writings, every case was then decided. But notice how it says it in spiritual gifts. Just a little different. I saw that every case was then decided. Another I saw statement. And I'm bringing these points to you so that you understand this is not simply an opinion of Ellen White's. This was something that she received under divine revelation. I saw that every case was then decided for life or death. Jesus had blotted out the sins of his people. He had received his kingdom, and the atonement had been made for the subjects of his kingdom. While Jesus had been ministering in the sanctuary, the judgment had been going on for the righteous dead and then for the righteous living. Now notice the sequence. The righteous dead first, and then who? The righteous living. The subjects of the kingdom were made up. The marriage of the Lamb was finished. And the kingdom and the greatness of the kingdom under the whole heaven was given to Jesus and the heirs of salvation. And Jesus was to reign as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Now I ask a question. Could this decree already have been given today? Could all probation be over? Or if not, could we today be in the judgment of the living? That's a solemn thought, because we're told in Great Controversy on page 490, the judgment is now passing in the sanctuary above. For many years, this work has been in progress. Soon, none know how soon, it will pass to the cases of the living. Now, that's published in the 1911 Great Controversy, but it was also published in the 1888 Great Controversy. And so it's been a few years. And she said at this time it had been going on for a while. And she says, soon, none know how soon it's going to happen. But the question I have for you right now is, has it happened today? Because we need to understand that. And the answer is simply, no, it hasn't happened yet today. And here's why we can say that. There was at one time a sister in the Advent movement by the name of Anna Phelps. Remember who she was? Mm-hmm. She was someone that she was thinking that she was having divine revelations, and even people like A.T. Jones, E.J. Wagoner were backing her and saying this was right. And one thing that she was teaching was that the image of the beast was going to be formed after the close of probation. And Ellen White was writing to a brother and sister, Garmine, about this. And notice what she says. You say that Anna's visions place the forming of the image of the beast after probation closes. This is not so. You claim to believe the testimonies. Let them set you right on this point. The Lord has shown me clearly that the image of the beast will be formed before probation closes. For it is to be the great test for the people of God by which their eternal destiny will be decided. Your position is such a jumble of inconsistencies that but few will be deceived. Now, we need not be deceived. Ellen White says in this statement that the Lord has showed her that the image of the beast will be formed before probation closes. And it has to be formed before probation closes, because it's going to be the great test for the people of God. Now, what is the great test on?
Sabbath.
The Sabbath test. Sure, the real Sabbath. Amen?
Amen.
Okay. It's going to be a test over whether we really know and serve God or not. But she says that the image of the beast has to form to produce this great test. And although the image of the beast is continually being formed in front of our eyes, we know that the Sunday law hasn't happened yet. We know that we haven't been brought to that great test. And therefore, because it's by that great test that those living that their eternal destiny will be decided, we can realize, friends, the judgment of the living hasn't started yet. It hasn't started yet. But remember this, that when the image of the beast is fully formed and the great test comes upon us, then at any time, then at that time, the judgment of the living will begin, and at any time, it can be our time. But our time hasn't come yet. But I want to tell you something, friends. If I get killed today, if I die today, my probation's over. My time has come then.
Amen.
And so don't put off getting ready till next week or next year. Because we don't know that we have next week. We don't know that we have next year. We don't know if we have this afternoon. We don't know that. Now, Jesus gave his disciples a warning in Mark chapter 13, verses 35 through 37. Watch ye therefore the TV set and the internet and all the things that are coming upon the world. Is that what Jesus said? He says, watch ye therefore, for ye know not when the master of the house cometh, at evening or at midnight or at the cock crowing or in the morning. Lest coming suddenly he find you sleeping. And what I say unto you, I say unto all, watch. So these words that Jesus gave to his disciples, he said, I say this to everybody. You watch. You watch. In volume 2 of the testimonies, on page 190, Ellen White says, we are waiting and watching for the return of the Master who is to bring the morning. Lest coming suddenly he find us sleeping. What time is here referred to? No, not the final revelation of Christ in the clouds of heaven to find the people asleep. No, but to his return from his ministration in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary, where he lays off his priestly attire and clothes himself with garments of vengeance. And when the mandate goeth forth, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still. And he which is filthy, let him be filthy still. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. Volume 2 of the Testimonies, page 190. Now, with what words then did Jesus admonish his followers who would be watching for his return? In Matthew chapter 24 and verse 44, Jesus says, therefore, be ye also ready, for in such an hour as ye think not, the Son of Man cometh. What does Jesus say to do? Does he say to get ready? No, he says we're to be ready. Because, friends, we don't know when this is going to happen. We don't know how quickly these last movements are going to come. But one thing we've been told about them, they're going to be what?
Quick.
They're going to be rapid. She says the final movements will be rapid ones. Rapido. You know, fast. In volume 9 of the testimonies, on page 48, we are told, go to your rest at night with every sin confessed. Thus we did when in 1844 we expected to meet our Lord. And now this great event is nearer than when we first believed. Be ye always ready in the evening, in the morning, and at noon, that when the cry is heard, behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. You may, even though awakened out of sleep, go forth to meet him with your lamps trimmed and burning. That's what we must do. Now I want to talk in this next section about the final disposition of sin and sinners. Because, friends, sin is going to be destroyed. And we need to understand that. Sin is going to be destroyed. And God doesn't want to destroy a single sinner. But if we continue to stay sinners, he's going to destroy the sin in us. And we'll be lost. And it's not his desire to do that. Now I want to think about the Day of Atonement. On the Day of Atonement, where were the sins of the congregation finally placed?
On the scapegoat.
On the scapegoat. On the scapegoat. In fact, if we turn back to Leviticus chapter 16, let's go back there and read it. Leviticus 16, verse 20. It says, and when he hath made an end of reconciling the holy place and the tabernacle of the congregation, the altar, he shall bring the live goat. And Aaron shall lay both his hands upon the head of the live goat and confess over him all the iniquities of the children of Israel and all their transgressions and all their sins, putting them upon the head of the goat. And he shall send him away by the hand of a fit man into the wilderness. And the goat shall bear upon him all their iniquities into a land not inhabited. and he shall let go the goat in the wilderness. Now, this scapegoat represents Satan. There were two goats, remember? One was chosen for the Lord, one was chosen for Azazel. And the Lord's goat made the atonement. The Bible says the atonement was made with the Lord. But now it says that these sins for which had been atoned, which had been forgiven by the blood of the Lord's goat, now that they are symbolically placed upon this scapegoat. The scapegoat has a responsibility and must bear the responsibility that it is shared in these sins. You see, without Satan, Adam and Eve wouldn't have sinned. Without Satan, many things that we've done today, we would never have done too, because he's there to egg us on and to encourage us. It's just like when you have two men, and you see this, you hear about it all the time. For instance, a wife becomes upset with her husband, and she wants to have him murdered, but she's not going to kill him. She hires someone else to do it. So someone else comes in, shoots the husband, but the wife goes on trial also for murder, right? Because she has a shared responsibility. She didn't pull the trigger. She didn't do anything physically, you might think, to bring about the death of her husband. But she bears an equal, if not equal, or greater responsibility than the person who actually pulled the trigger, because she instigated, she had a part in it. And I'll tell you, friends, if the earthly courts are smart enough to understand this and to do justice, surely God's great tribunal is also. And Satan's going to have a shared responsibility in all these things that he has to accept. In Great Controversy on page 658, I have a two-slide statement here. It says, now the event takes place foreshadowed in the last solemn service of the Day of Atonement, when the ministration in the Holy of Holies had been completed and the sins of Israel had been removed from the sanctuary by virtue of the blood of the sin offering. Then the scapegoat was presented alive before the Lord, and in the presence of the congregation, the high priest confessed over him all the iniquities of the children of Israel and all their transgressions and all their sins, putting them upon the head of the goat, Leviticus 16:21. We read that earlier. And then she continues, in like manner, when the work of atonement in the heavenly sanctuary has been completed, then in the presence of God and the heavenly angels and the hosts of the redeemed, the sins of God's people will be placed upon Satan. He will be declared guilty of all the evil which he has caused them to commit. And as the scapegoat was sent away into a land not inhabited, so Satan will be banished to the desolate earth, an uninhabited and dreary wilderness. In Patriarchs and Prophets, on page 358, she says this, since Satan is the originator of sin, the direct instigator of all the sins that caused the death of the Son of God, justice demands that Satan shall suffer the final punishment. Christ's work for the redemption of man and the purification of the universe from sin will be closed by the removal of sin from the heavenly sanctuary and the placing of these sins upon Satan, who will bear the final penalty. So when we think, friends, about the plan of salvation in its broadest sense, it didn't finish at the cross. It didn't finish at the ascension of Jesus to heaven. And it doesn't even finish when probation closes, because this final eradication of sin hasn't yet happened. So this is what happens when the beginning of this ending process happens when Jesus comes back. Because it's, we noted, I think, in this statement in Patriarchs and Prophets that, going back to Great Controversy, it said he is banished to the desolate earth, an uninhabited and dreary wilderness. And we find that referenced in Revelation chapter 20, verses 1 through 3. So let's turn to Revelation chapter 20. He says, and I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years and cast him into the bottomless pit. Now, what is the bottomless pit? It represents the earth. And so Satan's here during that 1,000 years, when the earth is desolate and been destroyed, to contemplate upon what he has done, just as the goat was led out into the wilderness by the hand of a fit man. We're told in Great Controversy on page 660, for 1,000 years, Satan will wander to and fro in the desolate earth to behold the results of his rebellion against the law of God. During this time, his sufferings are intense. Since his fall, his life of unceasing activity has banished reflection, but now he is deprived of his power and left to contemplate the part which he has acted since first he rebelled against the government of heaven, and to look forward with trembling and terror to the dreadful future which he must suffer for all the evil that he has done and be punished for all the sins that he has caused to be committed. Friends, that's not going to be a fun time for Satan. He has 1,000 years. He has 1,000 years to have this, what she calls intense sufferings, to tremble and to have terror about what is ahead. What is then the final fate of Satan and all his followers? It's very clear what the Bible says. Let's turn to Revelation chapter 20. Revelation chapter 20 and verse 9. Satan and his hosts, after the 1,000 years, they try to make an attack upon the city of God. And since they went up upon the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about and the beloved city, and fire came down from God out of heaven. And what does it do? It says it devoured them, or it consumes them. In Proverbs chapter 11, in verse 31, it says, "Behold, the righteous shall be recompensed in the earth, much more the wicked and the sinner." We believe that one day we will inherit the earth. Jesus said the meek shall inherit the earth, right? The Bible says he's going to make an earth made new. We'll read about that in just a minute. And so we receive our, as it were, recompense, our reward on the earth. But the Bible says also that the wicked do also. And in Malachi chapter 4 and verse 1, it says, "For behold, the day cometh that shall burn as an oven, and all the proud, yea, and all that do wickedly shall be stubble. And the day that cometh shall burn them up, saith the Lord of hosts, that it shall leave them neither root nor branch." Doesn't sound very, very nice, does it? In Great Controversy, page 673, it says, "Some are destroyed as in a moment, while others suffer many days. All are punished according to their deeds. The sins of the righteous have been transferred to Satan, and he is made to suffer not only for his own rebellion, but for all the sins which he has caused God's people to commit. His punishment is to be far greater than that of those whom he has deceived. After all have perished who fail by his deceptions," and that would include the wicked angels as well, "he is still to live and suffer on. In the cleansing flames, the wicked are at last destroyed, root and branch, Satan the root and his followers the branch." It says some suffer on many days, friends. You know, we don't believe in an eternal burning hell, but don't get the idea that hell is just an instant either. It may be many days. And we don't have to be there, friends. We don't have to allow probation to close upon us. We don't have to have that fate. The Bible says that God's going to make a new, clean universe, and we can have a part of that fate. Amen. He's going to have a universe, friends, that is clean from all sin. John, in vision, he saw something that was going to replace this sinful world. In Revelation chapter 21 and verse 1, "And I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea." He says that this old earth that we had, it's going to be passed away. And there's going to be something that was in this earth, something that was a very predominant part of this earth in light of the great controversy, that's going to be missing in the earth made new. And that is sin. That is sin and all that defiles. Turn with me back to Revelation 21, again, verse 4. It says, "God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away." Friends, there's not going to be any more funeral homes. No more hospitals. No more insane asylums. And then in verse 27, "And there shall no wise enter into anything that defileth, neither whatsoever worketh an abomination or a lie." No sin will defile that great holy place, friends. In Psalms 84 in verse 11. It says, "For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly." Now, why did I read that verse? Because you might be thinking, well, you know, I'm not sure heaven's going to be so great because they might not have world wrestling in heaven. They might not have football in heaven. They might not have steak dinners in heaven. You know? Might not be some things there that I want. Well, friends, if that's true, it's because there's some things in our heart that aren't right with God. Because the Lord promises that he'll withhold no good thing from them that walk uprightly. Do you believe that?
Amen.
I believe that too. And so there won't be bad things there, friends. It's only going to be good things. Only that which is good. In Great Controversy, page 673, we read these words. In fact, this is the very last chapter of that great book, very last paragraph of the last chapter of that great book. The great controversy is ended. Sin and sinners are no more. The entire universe is clean. One pulse of harmony and gladness beats throughout that, or throughout the vast creation. From him who created all flow life and light and gladness throughout the realms of limitless space. From the minutest atom to the greatest world, all things animate and inanimate in their unshadowed beauty and perfect joy declare that God is love. They declare that God is love. Now, in that great city, if we turn back to Revelation chapter 22, we read that God has some things to restore. Revelation 22:2. In the midst of the street of it, and on either side of the river, was there the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits, and yielded her fruit every month, and the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. That tree of life, that very same tree of life, which was in the Garden of Eden, is going to be in the earth made new. And I think there's an even greater privilege that awaits us, friends, that God offers to us. In Revelation chapter 21 and verse 3, "And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God." What is the greatest blessing of heaven, friends? It's not that we can go through a pearly gate. It's not that we can walk on a street of gold. And it's not that we can eat of the tree of life. It's that we can have this personal, intimate, one-on-one, even physical contact with God. And he will dwell with us. In verse 22, it says, "I saw no temple therein, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are the temple of it." Chapter 22, verse 1. "And he shewed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb." And verse 3, we read verse 2 a minute ago. Verse 3, "And there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. And they shall see his face, and his name shall be in their foreheads. And there shall be no night there, and they need no candle, neither light of the sun. For the Lord God giveth them light, and they shall reign forever and ever." In Great Controversy, on pages 676 and 677, we read this. "The people of God are privileged to hold open communion with the Father and the Son." Who do we get to hold open communion with? The Father and the Son. Didn't mention anyone else, by the way. It says, "Now we see through a glass darkly," 1 Corinthians 13:12. "We behold the image of God reflected as in a mirror in the works of nature and in his dealings with men. But then we shall see him face to face without a dimming veil between. We shall stand in his presence and behold the glory of his countenance." Great Controversy, 676, 677. What a privilege. What a privilege, friends. It's true, probation is going to close soon. And the end of sin is going to happen soon. And it's going to happen whether it's with us or without us.
Amen.
Sin's going to end. But if it doesn't end in me, it's going to end with me. Do you get that? If it doesn't end out of me and I don't expel the sin from my soul, then I'm going to die with it. I'm going to be put away with that sin. We have a choice today, friends. The Bible says that we can come to Jesus just as we are. We need not be fearful at the close of probation. We need not be fearful of the last days. Let me read you a couple more texts here in closing. In 1 John chapter 4, I think we quoted this earlier, but let's read verse 4 together. 1 John chapter 4, verse 4. He says, "Ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world." If we are to be the temple of God and Christ in you, the hope of glory, Colossians 1:27, is a reality of your life, then you have that power of God working in you, and greater is that than he that is in the world. And we need not be fearful. And in chapter 5 and verse 11, he says, "This is the record that God hath given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God." Why have you done this, John? He says, "So that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God." Now, he didn't say anything about believing in the second person of the Trinity. He said, you believe on the Son of God. And when you do this, you know you have eternal life. But Lord, I don't feel like I have eternal life. It doesn't matter how you feel. Lord, my faith is weak. It doesn't matter. You just come to me with faith as small as a mustard seed. That's all you need. Because my arm is strong and my power is great. And if you'll simply come to me as you are, I can help you and make you ready for the close of probation, to end sin in your life, and through the final atonement, make you more precious than a fine golden wedge of ophir. And that's what he wants to do for each of his people. Aren't you glad?
Amen.
Aren't you glad that heaven's not going to be corrupted with a bunch of sin?
Amen.
Who would want to go to heaven if heaven was going to be a place of defilement? Like, it would just be like living in eternity on this earth. And that's not what we want, friends. We want eternity in a pure, blissful place where our characters are like the character of God. And we can have it if we'll follow Jesus. And friends, our probation hasn't closed yet today, but it could close soon. And all human probation will close soon. We know this is going to happen soon. And so Jesus says to watch, and he says to us today to be ready. May God bless you, friends, to be ready. May God bless you to be watching. And so that when that probation closes, whether it's your probation, I talked about this at camp meeting. At our camp meeting, we had preparing for the end as our theme. You remember that? And I had this idea of the keynote message of what I was going to preach on the keynote night about, you know, the time of trouble ahead and all these things are coming up on the. And then had a heart attack followed by a devastating stroke, and she was in a coma and she was out of it and she was dying. And I realized that her probation was over. She was still alive, but I realized her probation was over. And boy, how it changed my attitude and the way I looked at everything in an instant almost. And I realized, friends, that our probation can end in just a moment, even if we don't even die. But we can die pretty quickly. It all can happen fast, and we need to be ready today. We need to be ready now. I know some of us, like Sister Arlene, she's almost 90 now. And she probably thinks about it a little more seriously than someone younger like Kevin or Ashley. But friends, we all need to think seriously. We need to think soberly. Because the end is upon us. Whether we're older or younger, the end is upon us. And the signs of the times are here. If we can't see them, then we're worse than the Pharisees in the time of Jesus, who could discern the weather but couldn't discern the signs of the times. We're here. May God bless us to be ready.